afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. How are we doing this fine, fine day?
Fine!
Once again, my name is Devin Pike. Thank you very much for coming out and making Fan Expo Dallas the massive success that it is. We appreciate each and every one of you. Thank you very much, and we love you guys. Thank you, but we hope you're having a fan. Is everybody having a fantastic time today? Awesome. I do have a couple of rules to go over.
No.
See, there's not that many anarchists in the audience. I like that. It's nice. First off, we ask that you please refrain from flash photography while we're on stage, mostly because we have no souls and we don't need them stolen. So just a rule of thumb on that. Also, if you're in line for the questions, please do not ask for a selfie. Please do not ask for hugs. Please don't ask for donations to your Kickstarter. We appreciate that. It's just, our lovely guest also has photo ops available as well as the signing booth as well. That's the best time to do those. So, except for the Kickstarter, don't ask her for the Kickstarter either. And the final rule is, when addressing her, please do not call her the cavalry, okay? You've seen our next guest on ER. You have heard her as the voice of one of the most amazing princesses, Mulan. You've seen her in a number of roles, but you know her as Agent Melinda May on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. I bring you Ming-Na Wen!
The cavalry, right? Oh, did I just say that? She has to wear some boots.
Sassy.
Hi, Devin.
How are you?
That was a kind of cute little dance you did.
It's just me bouncing bat around. It works. I just aim and the jiggle just carries me over the rest of the day. It is an absolute gas to have you here. Thank you very much for coming out to Fan Expo Dallas. And you've been on our hit list really for a while because...
Is that a good thing?
It is. It is. Just having you here and being able to speak to somebody who has been involved in the Marvel Cinematic Universe on TV for the last two seasons as Melinda May on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Phenomenal job.
Thank you.
I want to get to your earlier career real quick. I'll ask a couple of questions, and we do have a lot of people ready to ask questions back here as well in the center. I'll talk a little bit about working in the Disney voiceover realm when you were voicing Mulan. Mulan was a real departure from a lot of the films that Disney had produced up to that point.
Right.
So when you're in production for that, was there any kind of pressure on you to really kill the part, or is it just, it's another voiceover? Because you've done several of those. I mean, it wasn't your first dance in Hollywood, obviously.
Well, it was my first big animation and doing voiceover work, and the fact that it was with Disney and the fact that they were creating a story that was solely based on Asian characters, you know, Chinese in particular, I felt, being a Chinese American, that was really important that they did it justice, which they did. They did an amazing job in, you know, telling this legendary story from China. And I always thought that they wanted this, like, kind of like little girl, like high voice. And no, they wanted my voice, which was really a coup, without an accent. Which was another coup.
Were you surprised at the reaction that audiences had for the film, in that there was always an undercurrent of Disney needs to branch out and be more diverse? Disney needs to tell more stories other than flaxen-haired princesses and everybody has a very similar skin tone and a very similar
When you
history.
Say flaxen.
Just very, either blonde or dark. Well, until Brave, it was always blonde or brunette. There were never any redheads.
Right,
so,
right.
You know,
yeah, that's right. Ariel,
that
you're
is
right.
True. You're right. Well, human.
Devin doesn't know what he's talking about. Horrible moderator. No, I'm very sarcastic.
I've insulted all the mermaid American population here.
Right. Well, I think Disney knew back then. I mean, Mulan is 20 years old. More than 20 years old. I think it came out in 19... Was it 93 or 95? 95, right? 95. So, yeah. And I think Disney felt that they needed to diversify, and that's why they were taking such a big risk. And on top of that, they were... really putting a lot of time and effort. I remember the directors and producers, they went to China, they did all this research. So it was important for them to get it right. And it still astounds me to this day that the younger generations, you know, fall in love with Mulan, and it's just so classic. That's the beauty of Disney. So, and here's my Disney way, Princess way to everybody.
I love following you on Twitter and Instagram because I love seeing all of these bracelets that fans around the world have given you. Is this all from Dallas or?
No, there were about five that I wore that were from other cons. And I don't know how this started, really. I think it did start on Twitter when somebody noticed that I wore beaded bracelets, and then a few people started bringing them to the cons, and I started tweeting about it.
I'm getting tired.
I've been signing autographs all day. And then it became this thing where, because I love beaded bracelets, I love stone and wood and anything that's handmade, that, you know, there's a lot of energy and love from it, and it's just a wonderful way for me to bond with you guys. So thank you so much for all the ones who brought me beaded bracelets or any sort of bracelets. Thank you. It's, you know, I love coming to these things because it really is about connecting and sharing.
And it's gotta be gratifying because you'll spend months in production, you know, basically, you know, a week or 10 days filming each episode, and it's almost in a vacuum in and of itself. This is an opportunity for actually, and Clark Gregg's another one, we had him here in town for the indie film that he did at Dallas National Film Festival.
Why didn't Clark Gregg get a little applause?
Is there one fan interaction you've had through all the various roles you've had that just said, okay, this is why I do this job? Is there one that you can like pull out of your file cabinet and say, that was it, that's it?
Put it an episode?
Or really just anything, any of your roles. Because, I mean, there are people who know you specifically from ER.
Right.
People who know you specifically from there. She's on S.H.I.E.L.D. too, guys.
Just that what makes me want to do it all the time and kill myself and have 3 hours sleeps, yeah. It's absolutely the passion and the love for what I do. And, you know, on the one hand, we live in this kind of little bubble where we go into the studio and we shoot hours on end. And then, you know, I come to one of these things and it's so gratifying because I'm a girl that was trained in theater. So to have that connection and to know that, oh, there are actually people watching the show and, you know, and being inspired by it or whatever that gives them the joy of, you know, connecting with the characters or the stories. I mean, that's why I love my job. You know, it's just all about just entertaining as well as connecting with people, so.
And we've got a ton of questions, and we're gonna get started with somebody who's been in here from the entire panel. Good to see you in the Fez, hello.
Hi.
Hi.
As Agent May, you don't show very many emotions. How do you prepare for that?
What do you mean? She's very emotional. She cries on the inside. And laughs on the inside, and it's, you know, it was a very difficult role in the beginning because I wasn't sure who Agent May was. There wasn't much in the pilot episode about who she was, except there was this mysterious thing that happened in Bahrain, and so it, you know, made her give up being a S.H.I.E.L.D. agent out in the field. And I had to really trust the writers and believe that they had a journey for her. And so for me, it's about feeling all those emotions, but keeping them locked up inside of me. And I think what was so wonderful is that so many people related to her, which surprised me, but I think a lot of us do that, you know? We kind of bottle up our feelings and we don't show who we love or, you know, if we're in pain. And that's May, so yeah. It's all on the, it's all in my eyebrow. I show it in my eyebrow.
And every now and then there's a smirk.
A smirk, yes, every now and then. And then she beats somebody up.
Right on here.
Hi, so thanks for coming to Dallas. And
glad to be here.
If you had any superpower, what would it be and why?
Oh. If I'm in LA, I love to have teleportation. So so I'm never stuck in traffic. if I'm in Dallas lately, I think I wanna be able to have a big umbrella. But yeah, that's it.
I'm on the 405. I'm never getting off the 405.
Oh, it's the worst.
Right.
Are you going to tie into anything else in Marvel? And if you are, how?
Get that movie money.
I don't know. It's totally up to Marvel. Marvel, you know, there's the cinematic world, and then there's the television world, and they have interlinked us. But as far as what their future plans are, you know as much as I do. Yeah, you know Marvel. They really don't tell us very much. So, and I wouldn't tell you even if I knew.
Disney has snipers stationed where we can't see them.
All right. Hi, my name's Hunter. I give you the purple beaded bracelet.
Thank you.
And so, my question is, since we kind of got to see May's romance with her ex-husband and kind of her romance with Ward in season one, is there any romance that May will be in season three?
I think you're interested in a particular storyline for May.
This is that connection we were talking about.
Well, listen, we have a lot of hunky guys on our show, and I'm sure we're going to have a lot of new ones, so I'll take any of them.
Okay.
My husband's not listening, is he?
There's no way for this to ever get out on the internet. You're fine.
First, start off by saying I follow you on Instagram and that you picked the best pair of cowboy boots because I know you were asking everybody which one to pick, and I voted for those. So.
Thank you.
My question is, you've done a lot of voice over acting, not just Mulan, but Final Fantasy Spirits of End, which is one of my favorites. If someone approached you and wanted you to do another really large, big theater movie as a voice actor, would that be something that you would feel like you would take on again?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I know for my 9-year-old son, he wants me to be in the next Lego movie. So I'm working on that.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I just work for my kids, you know.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, Ming-Na.
Hello.
So, aside from being a really great actress, what's something else that you're really good at?
Can you say that again really loud? Sorry. I'm sorry.
Aside from being an amazing actress, what's something else you are really good at?
You know, my new motto is I am a woman of many talents. I'm gonna just have that as my introduction from now on. Ming-Na Wen! Welcome, Ming-Na Wen! Woman of many talents. I love to cook. Both my parents were chefs, and so I'm a major foodie, and I love gardening, and I'm writing something right now for the future. I'm writing a lifestyle book, and I drink the blood of young. I'm a vampire. But yeah, I'm writing a lifestyle book right now too.
About being a vampire.
About being a vampire, yeah. Secrets to staying young.
Hello.
I like your t-shirt.
Thank you. Represent.
Now representing.
First off, I'd just like to say that I didn't think it was possible, but you're even more beautiful in person.
I paid him to say that.
And my question is, what was your reaction when you found out that you were gonna have to throw down with Sky this last season?
Yeah, that was great. I mean, talk about an evolution of two characters, you know. May didn't trust Sky, didn't believe in her potential, and then as time went on, she became her SO. And then to have, you know, her turn on May, we were ready, you know, we were excited about doing that girl-on-girl fight scene. And you know what? She cheated, can I just say? If it wasn't for her inhuman power, I would have kicked her ass.
I was actually at the San Diego panel where they debuted the debut episode, the pilot episode, and brought, you know, you guys all out. And it was so great seeing everybody was just so gleeful to be able to not only talk about the project publicly. I'm curious about the casting process on it. I can't imagine anybody in May's role other than you. So talk a little bit about
me neither.
There you go. Talk a little about the casting process, and because I mean, there had to have been such a rigorous thing for not only Marvel but also for Disney as
you
well.
You mean in the beginning?
Yeah.
Wow. You know, every actor I know had a different process. I know Chloe went through, like, they put her through the ringer because, you know, they were looking for this young ingenue. So thank God I wasn't one of those. But they brought me in, and at that time, the character wasn't specifically written for an Asian. And I was so nervous to audition for Joss Whedon that I couldn't memorize my lines to save my life. It was two pages of dialogue, and you know, after having been in the business for a couple of decades, it was amazing to me that my brain would not work. And then, but you know, somehow I challenged myself and got over that hurdle. Put in a great audition and felt really good about it. And then I was offered the role right after. And they changed the name too, because originally the name of the character was Agent Althea Rice. Rice. And it was Marissa Tencheron who actually brought it up, because apparently Joss and Jed and Jeff Bell, it didn't even occur to them. But Marissa, being Asian, she was like, I don't think we can call her Agent Rice anymore. Thank goodness.
Yeah, I can imagine all those awkward interviews later on down the road. Right down here.
Yes, I saw you practice martial arts very good on the show. So, do you actually practice martial art?
Yeah, but I always like to say that I'm really good at faking things. Because I don't know if you know, all my cast members make fun of, well, they always know that I'm into the innuendos. Okay, anyways.
Did I ever answer your question?
I have taken training in the tiger claw method. I took some taekwondo, but because kung fu doesn't have belts, you know, so I don't have any belt as far as where I'm at in my training. But I do still continue to train with some of the stunt women who work alongside me, and they do wushu. So it's pretty intense, and I like it. But I'm still working on it. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. You want me to do a kick for you? I have to say, this is what the men of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. don't have to worry about, is having to, like, you know, having to do...
Somebody said they're going to the insurance company. What's the old Fred Astaire quote about Ginger Rogers? Ginger did everything I did, but backwards and in heels, so it was always more difficult for her.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Right down here.
Hi, my name is Michelle, and I was just wondering when you found out what happened in Bahrain, and how you reacted once you found out.
Yeah, I don't know I'll try not to give anything away.
It's been a month, people. Come on.
Yeah, catch up. You can't keep waiting for Netflix.
That Live Plus 7 number is big.
$1.50 on iTunes already.
How do you think season 3 got here? Come on.
I was really... I wanted to know so much about May's backstory. You know, and to have to wait a year and a half before that episode was revealed, I was very nervous about reading it, I was worried. And even after I read it and I was so excited about it, I was worried that it wasn't going to meet the audience expectations. You know, because you build something up, a backstory up, and the mystery of it for so long. But Gary Brown, who is one of your friends,
one of my co-hosts,
or so Devin says,
Whatever.
I'll go to Gary. Gary, yeah, I met Devin, your friend. He's like, who? No.
Don't be a code for
it. But Gary Brown directed it, and it was just, I was so happy with the episode, and then I was so happy when it aired, the response that the audience had, you know, to it. It's such an important aspect of her character. And to be able to go back and actually see why she became Agent May, it's pretty amazing. Yeah, you know, because there's a lot of real serious issues involved with it, you know, with post-traumatic stress syndrome. You know, I think that's what's so great about Marvel, is that even though it's a comic book, it really is about humanity, and it's really about real issues and coping with a lot of relationship problems and political issues and the world at large, but you know, we kind of wrap it up in this fantasy world. So I was really grateful for it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm a little short, but do you personally know
there's
what?
There's no little short, you're a lot short.
No, you're, but do you,
everything, you know what, you know, can I just say,
yeah.
I'm short too.
Oh
and,
yeah.
And good things come in small packages.
Right? Okay, but do you personally,
okay, whatever, mom.
Do you personally know what S.H.I.E.L.D. stands for in your new TV show?
Do I know what S.H.I.E.L.D. stands
for? Yeah.
Like, in what sense?
Like, like what S-H-E-L-D.
Oh, like the, yeah. Like the,
the abbreviation.
The abbreviation?
Yeah.
Strategic Homeland Intervention Enforcement and Logistic Division.
Next.
Marvel's Acronyms of S.H.I.E.L.D.
That's the word I couldn't get.
Especially towards the end. In season 3, to lighten the mood, what would your opinion be on doing a musical episode?
It is a Joss Whedon property after all.
I think we'll save that for season 9. We've completely jumped the shark. But yeah, no, I don't foresee. Although we did do some ballroom dancing already, so. Yeah, did everybody like that? Yeah, that was a real challenge. I was really worried about the ballroom dancing, more than the fighting. More than any of the fighting stuff that we ever did, was the ballroom dancing.
Okay, out of your cast cohorts, who is the most likely to say, absolutely, we're doing a musical, and jumps in, and who is the least likely to jump in and start singing?
I think Clark would, like, totally go for it. Yeah, he would just do it just because he, you know, he's such a goof.
Yeah.
And who's least likely to start singing?
Ian. Yeah. Without a doubt.
In your opinion, what do you think Mulan would think of what May's done so far?
Oh, I think Mulan would be very proud of Agent May. In fact, I think Agent May is probably a descendant of Mulan.
All right, fanfic writers, get to work.
Hi, Ming. So,
hi.
With your issues with Sky, since y'all have the big girl fight now, do y'all think y'all will ever be friends again and, you know, lovey-dovey sister bond?
Well, she's grounded for a while. I certainly hope so. You know, I don't think, I mean, in fact, I think in the last episode, you saw May understanding why Sky made the decisions that she made, you know, and May's, I think, response to Sky in giving her forgiveness was to say, my head still hurts. Because Sky knocked her out for a while. And I think that's her way of saying, you know, I forgive you. It's kind of like my dad when he says to my brother, you no good son. I tell my brother, that means he says, I love you. May's got a little of that.
At the end of season 2, May just suddenly left. Where do you think she went? Because all I've heard is that she's probably taking drugs on an island.
The island of Tahiti. Yeah, I don't know. Like, you mean penicillin, right? Drugs in, like,
Tylenol,
yeah. Aleve.
What was your reaction when May and Ward hooked up?
Oh yeah. until we realized what he was really about. But still, I think even then, oh yeah.
Will we ever see a Philinda kiss?
I don't know. I mean, I love that you're a Philinda fan. Thank you. Who else? I know, I just love the relationship that May and Coulson has because it is about friendship and loyalty and being co-workers and you know, soldiers together, but there's definitely affection, you know, in there somewhere. Who knows?
I don't mind it. He's one of the cute guys on the show.
Who do you think would be the most likely out of the cast of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. to be able, worthy to lift Thor's hammer?
That's a loaded question, baby. When you ask me that question.
I've already put in my vote.
I'm sure May would give it a good effort in lifting Thor's hammer.
Yes, Judge.
What Marvel's like would you recruit if May needed help on S.H.I.E.L.D.?
What Marvel?
And why?
Villain would I recruit?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, to recruit a villain?
Yes.
Oh wait, no, to help fight a villain.
Yes.
A villain to fight.
Oh. Ooh, that's a really tough question
you asked me. I mean, I love Loki, but I don't know if he could ever be...
Okay.
That's a good question, I'm stumped. I mean, Loki comes to mind because he's my favorite villain. Who would you like?
I would have to go with Red Skull.
Oh boy, yeah. I don't know how much help he'd be. But yeah, he's a big bad. Yeah.
Thank you, Judge.
Maybe if we brainwashed him.
Hi, Joker.
Oh, Riddler. No, Joker. Yes.
Yes, it's the Joker.
It's the Joker.
You're stuck, DC.
Let's get to you. For being part of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, which movie or movie character do you want to be in and why?
Well, I think I would want to be Agent Melinda May. And be alongside some of the Avengers, whether it's with the Black Widow, of course, Thor, you know, Iron Man. I mean, how much fun would that be? That I'm already living such a geek girl's dream by being in the Marvel world, so any bone they want to throw me, I'll take it.
I mean, with Civil War coming, we've already seen that the cast is already bigger than what we saw in Avengers. I'm almost surprised that they haven't even been able to ask any of the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. crew to show up, at least just for lip service, if nothing else.
He said lip service.
You're rubbing off on me.
Okay, I gotta stop, I'm so crazy. I think, you know, if and when that happens, it's something that we probably wouldn't even be able to talk about if that did happen. Yeah, the snipers! But, gosh, I hope, you know, because I know my 9-year-old son would love for that to happen. He keeps asking me, Mom, when are you gonna be in one of the movies? Shut up.
I don't know, kid.
Because it was Joss Whedon, were you ever worried that he was gonna kill you off?
I still worry.
That is true. My wife and I are massive Whedon fans. We're sitting there going, this is a Joss Whedon show. Someone's gonna die in every damn episode.
I mean, did you see the finale? For those who saw the season finale for season 2, I mean, there were a lot of dead people.
Oh, yeah. Hey, I want to say it's been a pleasure watching on TV and seeing you on the screen and seeing you like on the bleachers over here. It feels wonderful to see you.
Thank you.
No problem. Aww. My question
I'll give you my number later.
Hey, I got married, Jane. Sorry. Respect. But my question is, if you were to choose who would be in the Civil War, what side?
What are you doing? Are you Andrew Garfield?
What are you doing?
There,
Elizabeth.
Who would you be? What side?
If I was to be in some... Of course, for the side of good.
I mean, both are good. It's just two different ethics of the way they think.
Heroes or regulated heroes?
I know. I don't care as long as I'm in the movie. Damn it. I'll take any side.
Okay, we've got season 3 of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. coming. Have you started production yet, or when we go in front of cameras?
Oh no, I'm in that blissful state called hiatus.
Yeah.
It's so awesome. I mean, we had a killer schedule for season 2, and I'm looking forward to going back to work, but not until the middle of July. So, yeah, we go back a lot earlier than most people do for a series because of all the post-production stuff that our incredible VisFX team has to do. I mean, it amazes me every single week when I see the final product because we shoot our episodes in 8 days, and then our VisFX people have at most 2 to 3 weeks to get all those special effects put in, plus the music by Bear McCreary, our VisFX team headed by Mark Kopak. These are superhuman beings. I'm serious. I don't know how they do it, but I'm just thankful that they're there.
Did you tell your agent there's no way I'm working during hiatus, or were there other projects you were able to
I'm see? Here, aren't I?
You're internally great. I'm talking about any other film work, small.
Yeah, I try not to because literally we have 2 months. But you know, if any of the, I don't know who's some great directors right now. There's so many great directors. It really depends on the project and if I can fit it in. So, but yeah, I try to take the hiatuses off. So.
That's a smart idea, actually. Yeah. Get some rest in.
Yes.
And with the amazing career you've had so far, and at the age of 29, you have your whole career ahead of you, so it's phenomenal.
Thank you, Dad.
Is there one role now that you would like to play that you have not had a chance to do yet?
Everybody knows, right? No? Nobody knows what my bucket list is? What? Oh, the live action movie. Yeah, I do hope they call me. Hello? No. Well, Carrie Fisher was sitting next to me in the signing, and my bucket list is to be any character in one of the remaining Star Wars movies. That's my ultimate bucket list. I mean, to be a Jedi would be absolutely the coolest. Just the fact that I was working with Samuel Jackson, and I was that close to a Jedi, and now I'm sitting next to Carrie. Do you know Carrie flipped me off today? It was the best. It was so amazing. Because when she showed up, I just like made this huge announcement. You know, it's Carrie Fisher, everybody. And everybody cheered and she flipped me off. It was awesome.
On behalf of everybody here who is a fan of not only strong female characters, but fantastic characterization on TV. It is an absolute gas to see you in action every week on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Thank you very much for coming and sharing some time with us. It's an absolute pleasure.
Thank you.
The amazing